This is our next unit called Structures and Forces. And in this little video, we're going to look at the common designs of natural structures with certain manufactured or produced or people-made structures. So the design between the two is the focus there. We will also look at how certain structures are classified in some ways. So the first one we're going to look at is or just structures. Structures are basically anything. They can be natural, they can be manufactured, made by us. Pretty much anything you can consider would be a structure. So the premise here is that there are lots of, obviously we're inspired by nature, being natural ourselves, I suppose. But for example, if you look here, we've got a duck's feet, has a very distinct form. We've got our main structures where the bones are, and then you've got this fleshy part in between, the web part, that makes ducks and other birds very effective at moving through water. If you look at flippers that we, you know, throw on ourselves when we go swimming, diving and such, it's basically the same design. You've got these ribs, I guess, these solid ribs in the flipper, and then you've got material in between, and that helps us to move through the water very well. So these two, the duck's feet and flippers, have a very common design. Another one could be bird's wings. That's a nice, pretty bird. What do you think in our produced materials, things that we make ourselves, is patterned after the wings of a bird? Okay, it's pretty obvious, right? Plane wings is patterned after bird wings. Gliders, lots of things are patterned after the wings of birds. So these are two examples, and we could spend a lot of time here. Some things that students come up with are flying squirrel and a squirrel suit. That's always a really popular one. We could go animal claws, like a cougar's claw and a knife, right? Or a pick, something like that. We could also look at the fur of an animal and a person's winter jacket, right? They also have a lot of commonalities as far as their design goes. So there's lots of things that we pattern when we produce things. We pattern after nature. Okay, next concept is on how we classify structures. And this one, I don't know, every year I talk about how I kind of disagree with some of these. There's a lot of overlap. Let me just explain it first, and then I'll kind of come back to what I'm really talking about. So this is one way to classify structures, is to classify them as either being a complete solid, or being shell-shaped, or being a frame. Whoops, my computer's being wonky. So let's look at the first one. So structures that are solids, this means that they have, it's made from a solid piece of material, which has little or no space in between the pieces or the parts, right? So classic examples are rocks and pucks. Although, I mean, if you think about it, there are rocks that do have some space in between them. Like pumice is a one that comes to mind. There's lots of gaps in between the material of a rock. But generally speaking, it's pretty solid. Puck, obviously, is very solid. You could think of maybe a sponge, right? Very light, very porous. And some would consider that to be a solid. However, some would consider it to be something else, and we'll come to that. The next one is a shell, shell shape. So things that fall into this category are structures that have a solid outer edge. Okay, maybe rounded, doesn't always, but it's definitely hollow, has a hollow inner area. So here's a couple of very classic examples, an eggshell and a bowl or a cup. Some other things that I would consider a shell would be if we had I was dead and you looked at my skull, right, without a brain in it, that would also be a shell shape, right? How about an ice cream bucket? it's not completely rounded, right? But in my estimation, that would be a shell shape. A spoon is also another one that falls into that category. The last category is a frame. So frame structures are made up of many parts, multiple parts, that are connected in some way. They have open spaces between those parts as well. And two really good examples are a bike and a skeleton. So with a bike and a skeleton, you can see they're made up of several, like multiple parts, but there's always space in between them, right? And in some cases, those structures have material that fills in those spaces. But with the case of a skeleton, if you just have the skeleton, yeah, that's a classic skeleton. Some other examples would be a dining room chair. That's a frame structure. The desk that you're sitting in, or sitting in at school at least, that's a frame structure as well. A car could be considered a frame structure. Now, just to stir the pot a little bit, there's lots of overlap, right? If you go back to the structure of a sponge, right? It's pretty much a solid piece of material, although it's very porous. Some could say that those hollow inner areas in the sponge are rounded and can then be considered a shell. Also, some might think that with that sponge, again, there is, look at this, space between the parts. So if there's space between the parts, then maybe that sponge is also a frame. You could look at maybe a square Tupperware container. Some would say that it's a frame, right? It has the different parts of it, the walls of the Tupperware container that are connected, and they have space between them. So maybe that's a frame. Some may also say that that is falling into this category of a shell, right? Where they have a solid outer edge and is hollow on the inside. So there's lots of, you can make an argument for either one of these with many structures. So although this is a way of categorizing structures, I think there is a lot of variance in how you would categorize them with this criteria. Okay, so those are the first couple of concepts in this new unit. What I'd like you to do next, oops, I almost forgot, is you should be able to come up with, aside from the examples that I have up here, try and fill in the spaces here. Try and come up with, just look around the room that you're in right now and come up with three things that you think are shells, three things that you think are frames, and three things that you think are solids. And just kind of talk to yourself, make sure no one's listening, or go talk to your parents or siblings or your dog or whoever, and explain to them why you think they fall into each of those categories. Okay, now I'm done.